Beyond Breast Cancer on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Medical Society Alliance, Incorporated.
Greetings and welcome to Beyond Breast Cancer. I am Emily Lux, Program Director at Breast Cancer Support Services, and I'm joined in studio with Sophia Stopper, Program Coordinator at Breast Cancer Support Services. Before we jump into our segment on genetic testing and cancer risk assessment, I want to talk a little bit about BCSS as a whole. Breast Cancer Support Services of Berks County, or BCSS, is a survivor-driven organization. BCSS is a nonprofit organization that provides hope, emotional support, education, and resources to every person affected by breast cancer. Conception was in fall 1993 and operations began in 1994. The initial goals of BCSS was to implement support groups, establish a support line, and compile a resource book. These programs were started at no cost and remain at no cost to the survivor and their family members. We do not offer any kind of medical advice, and we offer our programs to anyone that is receiving treatment or in their survivorship at any medical facility in the area. So then we will go into our guests. I'm going to introduce Diane Rose, Vice President of Volunteer Programs at FORCE. Facing Our Risks for Cancer Empowered, or FORCE, is the only national nonprofit organization dedicated to improving the lives of millions of people facing hereditary breast, ovarian, pancreatic, prostate, colorectal, and endometrial cancers. As a BRCA mutation carrier, Diane is personally invested in this cause. Diane has been a leader in growing the organization's volunteer team to over 350 individuals and developing and implementing Volunteer FORCE Academy training. In 2017, Diane assumed directorship of FORCE's Research Advocate Training Program. Diane coordinates and trains consumers for involvement in all aspects of research advocacy, including preparing volunteers to participate in consumer reviews and also for peer review. Diane also focuses on developing, nurturing, and expanding relationships and collaborations with other organizations. So thankful that you could join us today, Diane. And I'm gonna let Sophia introduce our other guest, Donna Lamp.
Okay, welcome to Donna. Thank you for joining us today. Donna has served over 40 years of clinical professional nursing experience, with 15 years serving in her current role as the coordinator for Cancer Risk Evaluation Program. She earned her RN degree from St. Joseph School of Nursing and her Bachelor of Science degree in nursing from Alvernia University. She is a 2018 graduate and active alumnus of the City of Hope Intensive Care Risk Assessment course. She is recognized as a credentialed clinical genomics nurse awarded through the Nurse Portfolio Credentialing Commission for excellence in genomic nursing and is certified in cancer genetics and risk assessment. Donna is also a board certified case manager with a specialty focus in oncology. She is a member of the International Society of Nurses in Genetics and a member of the National Consortium of Breast Cancer, Inc. She is a trained volunteer for FORCE and genetic expert group leader in the facilitation of local FORCE support meetings. She participates as a team leader of the Medical Center's Clinical Ethics Committee. She has been honored as one of the founders of the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce and Industry's Women to Women organization. Thank you, Donna, for joining us.
So we're going to jump into questions with both of these two esteemed guests that we have. Sophia, do you want to start off by asking Donna a little bit about cancer risk assessment?
Sure. So hi, Donna. Let's get started. Can you explain what a cancer genetic risk assessment is and its purpose?
Yeah, so cancer genetic risk assessment is really a personalized approach to understand and an individual for them to learn exactly how they should be managed based on their own personal risk factors for cancer, also family history of cancer. And so it's a pretty streamlined process, and it's become, you know, very simplified in the fact that the individual completes a survey either online or paper form, and those individuals have their own personal risk factors. Some personal risk factors, you know, could be, you know, even age, or it could be hormonal replacement. At what age did an individual, get their period or start their menstrual cycle? We know that girls are starting younger and younger, getting their periods, and so that can be a risk factor in the future. We look at other risk factors too, you know, even an individual's risk for developing colon polyps or lifestyle risks, such as a history of smoking or alcohol use, and what are the environmental exposures. Some women have lesions in their breasts that we consider high risk. And those are women that, you know, we need to manage their risk maybe a little bit differently than the average person. And then we look at family history. Family history is very important because we look to see, is there a pattern of cancers in a family that could be linked to certain cancer genes that could be hereditary. Most cancer is non-hereditary. However, we're learning more and more about the genes that are linked to cancers. And years ago, we put all of our eggs in one basket and pretty much tested for two major genes, BRCA1 and BRCA2, which stands for breast cancer gene 1 and breast cancer gene 2. Males and females are born with these genes, and some individuals were born with a mutation in one of those genes, in a copy either inherited from mom or from dad. And those individuals we know are at a much higher risk to develop not only breast cancer, but also ovarian cancer. We see prostate cancer in males. Sometimes we see pancreatic cancer, and even some other cancers that are linked with those genes, and even other hereditary genes associated with cancer that we see in the family. We do ask for details in the family history, so sometimes young onset cancer can be a red flag and suggestive of hereditary cancer. And again, you know, we look for that pattern of cancers, and, you know, is that individual appropriate then for genetic testing? Genetic testing consists of a blood or saliva test, and we're looking to see, are there changes in the DNA associated with cancer genes that may have put those individuals at a higher risk to develop cancer? So we take that into consideration, and then we also outline a family tree or pedigree that looks like circles and squares. And it's a nice diagram of the family history. And that's really what helps us to determine whether or not an individual meets national cancer guidelines to offer genetic testing. And by the way, most insurances do cover genetic testing. Sometimes that's a misconception in the community, but more and more insurances are covering genetic testing. So don't let that be a barrier to you getting your own cancer risk assessment completed. Something else we look at are breast cancer risk models. These are computer generated models which determine individual's breast cancer risk. And that is based on family history, again, and also your own personal risk factors get calculated into these risk models. we come up with a calculated, we call it an empiric risk. It's EM as in Mary, P-I-R-C. And it's an estimated risk of what your breast cancer can be over 5 years, over 10 years, and even a lifetime risk for breast cancer. If your breast cancer risk is determined to be over greater than 20% lifetime risk, then you could meet criteria for breast MRI, which would be in addition to your mammogram. So you may have a mammogram and then in 6 months, breast MRI. So those individuals are getting closer surveillance. And that's whether or not they carry a mutation in a gene or not. This is just based on calculated risk models. These models are so sophisticated that they can determine a 5-year risk for breast cancer. And those are for individuals that are over 35. If your 5-year risk is greater than a certain threshold as outlined by the National Cancer Guidelines, you could meet criteria for chemo prevention. It's not chemo per se, it's a medication, we call it anti-estrogen, but it can significantly reduce an individual's breast cancer risk over time. And so there is a medication that is specifically for pre and postmenopausal women. And it's a medication that we actually give to women that are diagnosed with breast cancer, but we know that it given to individuals with no personal history and high risk as calculated by these models, it can reduce risk over a lifetime. There's another medication specifically for postmenopausal women. And that's important to know because this is a medication that was actually known for treating bone health. And so now I say we kill two birds with one stone. You know, we can increase your bone health and we can also reduce your risk for breast cancer. And so that really is a personalized approach to cancer risk and understanding truly what your risk is. Sometimes we're so worried about what the risk is for breast cancer, and then we do a comprehensive approach to your risk assessment, and you may be also at higher risk for colon cancer or some other cancers that are in your family. And so we would start that screening process much sooner than what we normally would for the average person. So this really is a very tailored plan of care. Each individual that completes a risk assessment, and like I said, it's as easy as sending a link to an email or paper form, you will also receive a plan of care that is personalized and structured in regards to how you should be screened personally throughout your lifetime. And so I think individuals are very, you know, happy to receive this information. Sometimes there's a fear about, you know, well, why would I want to know? But honestly, it's a personalized approach for you. And so we can reduce risk. We can provide education in regards to healthy lifestyle. Some individuals, because of a smoking history, may meet criteria for what we call low-dose CAT scan screening, which is for detection of lung cancer. And so, you know, we have individuals that are in their 20s that are coming here to have their risk assessed. Sometimes we see early onset polyps in some of our young adults. We're not really sure why that is happening, but it could be related to a hereditary condition. And by having a good risk assessment, we may be able to determine and maybe even put a finger on why these cancers are happening in the family. Most cancers we can't explain, but if we do find a mutation in a gene, we know that those individuals were at heads and shoulders to develop certain cancers. And the beauty of knowing is that we can get our hands around managing that risk with guideline-based recommendations. And, you know, it can also help the rest of your family as well. If there is a gene mutation in the family, the way it's passed on is typically 50-50. We call that autosomal dominant, meaning that, for example, if a parent carries a gene mutation, then each child has a 50% risk of having inherited that same broken copy of the gene. And knowing that can actually be life-saving because, again, just like there are national cancer guidelines to offer genetic testing, we have national cancer guidelines to manage an individual's risk carrying a gene mutation. And, you know, like I said, we used to test just for two genes, and now we have hereditary gene panels to really help us understand how to manage an individual's cancer risk.
Wow, those assessments are just such an important part of patient care. And I know that a lot of people are not sure if insurance will cover that or not. So it's very important to understand that it does. Most of them do, which is awesome. I'm glad that you mentioned that, Donna. And I just want to ask really quickly before we talk about FORCE, with the way that science has evolved and developed, when is it important or when could someone consider going back for a secondary genetic test to maybe get some more information about their own mutations?
And that's a really good question because in regards to genetic testing, we always advise that you have pre and post counseling so that you can really understand the interpretation of those genetic test results. The results can come back positive where we've identified a mutation in a gene and then we know how to manage your risk. It could come back negative, meaning that even if you test negative, sometimes genetic testing doesn't really explain what's happening with a person or in a family. Or we could get an uncertain result, where sometimes over time, that uncertain result could be actually reclassified to be a positive result, or it could be classified as totally benign, meaning nothing to do with the cancer that you are experiencing or what is in your family. So we don't base any clinical decisions on an uncertain result. So when an individual sees me and they say, oh, you know, I've had genetic testing or a member of my family has had genetic testing, I always ask to see those test results because before 2015, a lot of our genetic testing was really focused on the two major breast cancer genes that we were just talking about, the BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes. And like I said, a male can also carry a mutation, you know, in that gene. And so, you know, we want to make sure that no one is basing clinical decisions on an uncertain result. Or that the interpretation is understood, you know, by that individual. And so before 2015, if you had genetic testing, oftentimes we'll go back and update and actually add an additional panel of genes that we know could be associated with the cancers that we see in the family. There are other cancer genes now associated with hereditary breast cancer that runs in families. And so it's very important, you know, that we have a comprehensive approach. And so we always tell our individuals to please, you know, keep checking back with us, you know, every year. Those national cancer guidelines are always updated. So we want to ensure that you're getting the correct recommendations that's appropriate for you, you know, at that time. And we may go back and do additional testing as well.
Thank you so much, Donna. We're going to jump over then to Diane, and we're going to have her talk a little bit about FORCE as a whole, as an organization, then what kind of resources that are available for those that are dealing with hereditary cancer in their families.
Hi, good morning. Thank you for having me today. I just want to reiterate some of the things that you said in my introduction about FORCE. because I think it's important for people to really understand who we serve. And FORCE is the acronym for Facing Our Risk of Cancer Empowered. We're a national nonprofit organization, and we're in our 25th, we're celebrating our 25th anniversary this year, which is really exciting. And we really work with people to improve their lives for people who are facing the hereditary cancers. And those are breast, ovarian, pancreatic, prostate, colorectal, and endometrial cancers. And when I talk about improving the lives of those individuals and families, we're talking about people who have a genetic mutation, and they've identified that through, you know, someone like Donna, who's done their risk assessment, and they've been diagnosed with a cancer, and now they're, you know, going through that process. We also help individuals who we call previvors, and those are people who find out they have a mutation. Like myself, I carry a BRCA1 mutation, but I have not been diagnosed with a cancer. So I've gone through genetic testing, and then as Donna was talking about the various screenings that can be done to keep up with my cancer risk and make sure that I'm constantly being screened. But then there's also prophylactic surgeries that can be discussed to see if it's a good option for those people to help reduce their risk as well, or to go on some of those chemo prevention drugs that Donna was mentioning to reduce risk too. So we assist those people, those previvors, and then we also help meet the needs of the caregivers, people who are caring for these individuals, because with hereditary cancer, we know that the cancers run in families. So, you know, I inherited my mutation through my father, and so I might be helping him to manage his cancer risk. I'm managing my cancer risk. I have three children. I might be helping to manage their cancer risk. So it's a whole family affair, and we want to make sure that we're helping all of those people. And as Donna mentioned, there's so many genes now that are associated with hereditary cancer, the BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes, ATM, PALB2, CHEK2, P10. There's a whole list of genes. And then also people who are diagnosed with Lynch syndrome. And so we have the one resource that I would really guide people to is our website. It's one of the largest collections of expert-reviewed hereditary cancer information, which allows people to quickly find the information that they need for their specific situation. As you can imagine, with all of these different genes, they all carry a different risk for different cancers. We personalize that information on our website. So you can look up information specific to a gene, specific to a cancer, whether you're a caregiver, a previvor, or you're in treatment, and it pulls in that information that you need to know at that time. We really make it easy for people to find what they need when they need it. And so this includes information about genetic testing, your cancer risk management, cancer treatment, research studies, support. We also are involved in public policy initiatives to make sure that people have access to care and can afford that care. We have a webinar series of expert webinars. We have a post-mastectomy photo and video gallery, and that's of images of people who are our members, and they submitted these images and videos of their mastectomy and reconstruction, because when you're going through that decision, when you're in treatment and you have to have a mastectomy, or you're a previvor and you decide to have a prophylactic mastectomy, you have a lot of questions. What will my body look like? What are the options? And so this gallery helps you to look at other people, find your own body type, and you can kind of get an idea of what your body might look like. And then we also provide information and resources in Spanish.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing. That's quite illuminating. I have another question for you, Diane. It is, can you explain FORCE's X-ray program and its purpose?
Sure. So we created our X-ray program, and X-ray stands for Examining the Relevance of Articles for You. And this program was developed to help people kind of look behind the headlines to see what cancer research means for their situation. So it was really designed to bridge that gap between the scientific research and how it's covered in the media. So whether it's a news report that you see on television or something you see on social media or in the newspaper or even in a magazine, we know that media stories, you know, these things that you see in the news, are easier to read or easier to understand than reading a scientific journal article. But we also know that sometimes the media can be unreliable. They don't have all the information, or they've sensationalized the information and you know, to make it a draw for people to want to read it or listen to. So we've all seen media articles that pertain to cancer, and they draw different conclusions based on the same scientific report. So our X-ray program, we have two scientists who read that scientific information that we have a hard time understanding as regular lay people. They read it and they rewrite it. They rewrite it into plain language summaries of these scientific reviews. They rate the media on how relevant that is for people making decisions about that cancer news. So meaning, is there an action that I can take right now? Is there a new treatment that's available for my specific cancer? And it's showing promise, and I want to, you know, be involved in that either research study, or I want to be able to take that drug. Or is it research that's still being done in the lab and it's not ready for people yet? We also, in these articles, we link to relevant clinical trials. We link to those guidelines that Donna was talking about. You know, what are the screening recommendations? What are the treatment recommendations? And then other resources. And then we rate on how well the media did as they covered that research. So you can determine, is this a reliable source to get my information from?
Wonderful. That's such a great tool to use, because you're right, it's hard to follow some of the really scientific-based reports, but then when you get it on the news, it doesn't have all the information. So that's a really important piece for people to feel encouraged and informed about where the science actually is at that point. So I love that that is a part of the Forces website. I've been on there a few times looking at those, so that's really helpful. And I, as we're winding down, I wanted to focus a little bit about the support groups that Force offers. And I know that you and Diane, or you and Donna, you are Diane, you guys offer those quarterly through BCSS. So I wanted to give you a minute to talk a little bit about those support groups before we wrap up.
Sure, absolutely. So yes, you're correct. We offer support meetings for people who are affected by hereditary cancer. And we find that people, you know, really find comfort in knowing that they're not alone and that they can talk to somebody who's been in that same situation. They understand decisions that you have to face. And so our meetings at BCSS are hybrid. We do them in person, and there's also a Zoom link. So if you want to participate from home, you can do that as well. And you can talk with us, you know, myself and also Donna, and then everyone else who attends. So you're talking with, you know, the group leaders, the genetic experts, and then other people, and you're obtaining this information and resources, and you can ask questions. And it's really a safe and caring environment. We all want to be there to support each other, but also provide the information that you need to make that next step wherever you are, you know, in your journey. Force also offers other virtual support meetings for everybody in our community. So there are general support meetings for, you know, everybody to participate in, but then we also have specific support meetings. So we have a survivors group and a young survivors group, a pre-vivor group and a young pre-vivor group. We have a meeting for the LGBTQIA community. We have a men's group, people of color. We run meetings in Spanish and also in American Sign Language. People who are diagnosed with Lynch syndrome, and then people who are those caregivers and their and parents who have more specific questions as they're, you know, guiding their loved ones through, you know, through their journey.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. That's great that you have such a general group for everyone, but also you have those specific pockets to get that peer-to-peer feeling. So I love that. I want to make sure that I highlight our upcoming force that will be at the BCSS office. It's going to be on Tuesday, December 17th at 7. That is the hybrid format, so you can join us in person at the BCSS office, or you can email Donna for the link. That information is on our website. I want to thank Donna and Diane for joining us today. Such helpful information for those that are dealing with hereditary cancer or just want to be a little bit more knowledgeable about it as well. So thank you both for taking the time to be on the show today. And we will see you on the next episode of Beyond Breast Cancer. Have a great day.
Beyond Breast Cancer on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Medical Society Alliance Incorporated.